I was just in D.C. with him. We were did a Q&A with Chris Matthews and Chris Dodd and a lot of D.C. Journalists, which was quite interesting.
It's like a whole nother life since Telltale for you, I would think.
Well, that film, I wanted to try to make a psychological sort of horror thriller. You know, it was a tough one because a lot of producers and Ridley Scott was involved with that one. So that was a tough one. I would say out of all the films I made, that's sort of the most sort of pulpy or high concept type thing. You know, these are the movies I'm more interested in.
But I would think Homeland was a game
as a director.
but again, that was brought to me, and I did Dexter too. So I've always, I did their pilot and the whole first season of that. So that I would like that was the beginning of that kind of television, I think. So
yeah.
To do really bizarre characters like that. And I guess people just felt maybe I was right for that because I, made a couple of independent films that were dark like that. So,
how
to make it palpable or something.
So is that a universe that you, that is that a one of the choices? Is that a first choice? Is it a last choice?
People ask if we're any. I'm sure you talk to filmmakers. If it's something that I don't co-write or comes from me, it's something I don't know exactly what I'm looking for. I just let it wash over me, and if there's something about the main character that takes me, that I relate to in some way, and that I can inhabit and really understand, I think usually that's the thing that makes me attracted to it or decide if this is the next thing I'm going to spend a year and a half of my life on.
I think you probably shot more episodes than most pilot guys. You're not really in that like group of like we just do the pilot and disappear because there are guys who do that.
I did that. Dexter and Homeland, I did not do that for because I really believed in that piece. Both worlds. So that's why I stayed around. It's interesting because it's so hard to get films made, and I find the material. I mean, you hear this all the time. Everyone talks about the material on television right now is mostly more interesting. If you can get a budget and get to sort of realize that as a filmmaker, it's you don't get that opportunity that often. So I've been lucky, I think, to come across those projects.
So does it make it easier to go do Kill the Messenger or get a project like that together, or are people not?
Kill the Messenger, I was the last one to the mix of that because the script was around since like 07 or 08. And I think it was developed as like, a drama thriller of a journalist, what it is, at Universal. And I think because journalist films weren't doing well, they shelved it and it went to turnaround and then it sat around until Renner got involved. And I think with his sort of juices, like his bigger movies, he was able to get it greenlit. But it wasn't greenlit when I came on board, but Jeremy was attached as a producer and also an actor, and him and I have worked together before. So I think he probably made a big push to bring me on board.
So Ridley Scott made it, ironically, because I think it was Ridley's movie at Universal that probably got them off of the journalist movies.
Which one are you thinking about?
It was Body of Lies.
It was the one with Russell Crowe. And
yeah, it wasn't that. What did that one was? It was with him and Rachel McAdams.
Yes.
Yeah.
It was called.
And Ridley directed it.
No, he didn't.
Was it?
No.
Oh, I'm confusing movies.
No, he didn't. What the hell was it called? State of Play.
State of Play.
It was based on a BBC series, I think.
Yes.
Yeah.
And that was expensive and dead.
Yeah, like a film like this, we didn't make this for a lot. I made it more for like 12 and Holding or L.I.E. Those are little movies that I really put together. But, this was made at a relatively modest budget compared to those films, State of Play or Body of Lies, which are $100 million movies.
Yeah, crazy.
And the
movie started spending $100 million.
Jeremy, really believed in this project. He knew that it was something that he could really act in and dig into, so I don't think he was already getting paid on the other projects, so as well as me and I think everyone involved.
So do the small movies seem like a lifetime ago? Does it seem like a different...
I would do... You know, I work a lot really in television. I did a small movie before this one called Roadie that I co-wrote that came from my brother and I. And, you know, I took it to Tribeca and Magnolia put it out. And I loved doing those, man. I mean, I didn't get paid, but I was able... I deferred my fees, but... I was able to be working in television and make a living, and right. then go take 6 months and make that. And then editing was, because I was also one of the producers, I was able to shelve it and go back and forth in, and then finally finish it and take it to a festival and mm-hmm. find a little distributor for it. But I really love it because it's, you know, you have complete control of your work.
So do you have a thing at this point? I mean, do you have a sense of like, this is what I do, or are you just kind of always in search of a piece of material?
No, I think it's what I do. It probably frustrates my agents, you know, because I get sent a lot of, like, especially off of this film, you know, mm-hmm. I get sent a lot of thrillers, you know, straight more down the middle commercial thrillers. And, you know, most of them, you know, I always think if I'm going to spend a year and a half, 2 years of my life on something that's personal to me, I want to, it's got to be good. It's got to be truthful. Mm-hmm. So, if I could do TV around it and stuff where I know I could make it, you know, a better, you know, make a fee and make, you know, support my family, then I could still do those small films.
So you're happy being a working director as long as you sometimes get to be an artist?
Yes, very much. That's how you put it. Yes, exactly. I mean, I think most people would, I think a lot of filmmakers would say that. And I'll continue to do it. I mean, look, there are some studio projects that come in, and I was like, yeah, maybe I need to try something a little more commercial and a little bigger. And, you know, I'm entertaining one or two right now, mm-hmm. but it's, you know, I have a development deal with Fox, with television, so I was just speaking to a writer that I worked with before that has a really wonderful pilot, a cable thing, like a premium cable mm-hmm. thing about mega churches. Huh. And about church's business, and it's really interesting, and that's something that I would like really dig into from a television point of view. Do the pilot, maybe stay around, you know, mm-hmm. and be an executive producer. So creatively, you're right in there, and I work on that for a year.
So do you separate the idea of television or film or indie or studio? I mean, is it for you, is there a sense that world has now merged and it's all, you know, where you can get funded, where you have the right piece of material, where all that.
I feel like all the indie ideas, if you can call them that, are done on television. Like the script I just mentioned, written by Craig Wright, you know, who's a television writer. I met him when I was a guest director on 6 Feet Under many years ago. He was one of the staff writers, and he wrote something on spec, and mm-hmm. it's 65, 70 pages. You could easily make it into a feature, but it's just really complicated and interesting, and mm-hmm. the themes are deep, and it sort of reaches, and it's hard to get indie movies like that made, so it feels like a lot of the indie ideas are in television right now.
Well, 10 hours is a great opportunity to explore.
Yeah.
Like, you can't I can't imagine Kill the Messenger, the series.
Oh, you know, it's funny you say that. I mean, I do think that you could have taken Gary's book Dark Alliance, even, which the script is, you know, adapted from, one of the books the script is adapted from, and turn that into a miniseries, I think, because it's so dense. I mean, the story that he investigated is so, I mean, one of the reasons why he was brought down the way he was is that he didn't have enough graph space in the paper to get it all in. And eventually, as he was sort of going in his downfall of his career, this guy, Gary Webb, he tried to write it actually as a miniseries, but he wrote a book, and he was able to put everything in. So it's 500 pages, it's really dense, it gets into the history of all the characters, and which is really interesting, you know, mm-hmm. from the history of the Nicaraguan, the Civil War, and the Sandinistas, and the Contras, as well as Ricky Ross, and where Ricky came from. Mm.
So in a situation like this, do you get drawn in because Jeremy says, come, let's play? Or is the material that you have to find something personal in?
No, this story was Well, I remembered the story breaking in the 90s, and I remember it as the scandal of what it was, what he, what his allegations were, but and what the articles were about. I didn't, I wasn't familiar with what he went through as far as any discrediting or anything like that, and how the media, how other newspapers attacked him. And I just thought that was a story that hasn't really been told yet. And an important and kind of a necessary story, I think, to be out there, especially at this point, where we are right now with our, you know, in the world, and the state of journalism. So I really connected to that on the bigger scale, and then the smaller, of course, the more the micro of it is, I guess, the of the guy, of his passion, that the passion it takes to be an investigative journalist like that. And not taking no for an answer, and to be really dogged and kind of almost a cop on the beat type of mentality of being a reporter. And I just, I felt like guys like that are really important. And I related to his passion. And that's, I think, what made it easy for me to talk to Renner about the character, and come from character, come from him. His personal life and his professional life were both important to me, and both things that I related to. So
it's one of the things that's nice about the movie, and special about the movie, I think, is that it doesn't end up going after the beats that you would expect necessarily to show up in a movie like this. I mean, obviously it's based on real story, but a movie is a movie is a movie. But I mean, for me, Jeremy, it's almost like really the first time since Hurt Locker where he's kind of been able to give a performance that wasn't part of something that was trying, reaching for something. You know, it was like he was so, he kept it so close to the bone that it was just great to watch.
Yeah, we make him real, you know, and Renner is like, he doesn't ever have a false moment as an actor, so...
But he's been asked to read, you know, something like Bourne or whatever. It was, you know, being an action hero.
Well, it's an action. It's action. You know, that's an action thriller. You know, this was much more about, it's much more of a character piece. And it's very much, I think, a lot of things that people could relate to, when I related to, is to have your own bliss, your own thing that you really believe in, have it turn on you. And it's a sad story. It's I read something today. Someone wrote that, oh, it's All the President's Men with a really unhappy ending, which is fine, which is true. You know, he, a guy like that, a reporter's that age. How he's like seven, eight years older than me. I mean, he got out of college during the time when, or was in college during the time when the Watergate was breaking. And I think all the journalists wanted to be Woodward and Bernstein. And so how can it not be very much All the President's Men as far as the investigating and uncovering something that's way, way bigger than him? You know, so...
It's interesting they figured out how to respond to it now. I mean, I think that's the... The extra element of this film is like people that you realize that once Watergate had happened, the powers that be, whatever powers there are, figured out that when something like this comes down at them, the way to do it is to destroy the, kill the messenger.
Is to discredit the one, the outsider. I mean, he, you know, he didn't have, another thing that I found heartbreaking was that he didn't really have the Ben Bradley. The editor, like those guys had, a guy who had that power. You know, one, they were an outsider. They didn't have the connections in D.C. And I made a point of really showing that when he goes, there's a scene in the movie when he goes to D.C., he's clearly, like, it's David Goliath, almost. Like, you sort of know that he's biting off way more than he can chew, you know, and even the editors knew. And they supported him for a good amount of time, but ultimately they had to, you know, with all the corporate pressure, they had to back off. And the first one to get thrown under the bus is always the director, the writer, the person that inspired it all, that dug it up. You know, he's like a Doberman. He dug it up. Your editor is supposed to help you and is supposed to really figure out a way to get it all in there, and he wasn't able to. And he wasn't able to do follow-up either. That's another big thing, which we make a point of in the film with one simple scene. But he never got. He did find relatively vindicating things to dig more and things to that should have been printed that didn't get printed. Instead, they wrote an apology letter that mistakes were made. As soon as you do that, you're done. The journalist is done.
Yeah. Well, it did seem like they had an inferiority complex. You know, that thing about being not part of the, not New York Times, not the Washington Post. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, we can't really do this. This is not really our. Mm-hmm.
But it was right. But it was a time when during that time when the papers had more corporate pressure.
Yeah.
You know, there were more mergers going on, pairing companies. Less of that, like maybe in the 60s and 70s, what I know. And I know in the 80s and 90s, media started to become that sort of corporate monster.
Yeah.
That is very much like the studios, you know, very much like Hollywood, you know, yeah. of all these studios not being independent anymore. Maybe Weinstein is the only one left, right?
We don't even know who they really are.
But they're not owned. But, yeah. But it's the two brothers still call the shots.
Yeah.
You know, it's not like they're owned by Seagram's right. or some bigger corporate yeah. entity, you know. And that's the Merck was that. Oh, the Merck was going through that change at that time.
Right.
And that's one of the reasons why I think they did encourage a bigger story. You know, the mistake they all made mistakes, but a big mistake was to package it improperly. You know, package it as yeah. like the CIA's cooking crack in their basement, you know.
Well, they were ambitious for, I mean, that's the one of the interesting things watching it is, in the early days of the internet, they were kind of the cutting edge.
Mm-hmm.
And then you realize how quickly things change. And
well, yeah.
Once the other companies got as interested in the web as they were early on, they were no longer, you know, they've now been pushed aside.
Yes. They were the first ones to do it. That was the first story to really use it. I don't know.
Yeah.
I mean, we make a point of that in the movie, but they were the first ones. And it was Webb's idea, Gary's idea. I mean, he knew the story had a high unbelievability factor. And it's like, what can be better than the internet to allow people into my notebook, you know, and really see mm. see the source material, you know. and still, the irony is even with that, I mean, that's what caused it to break as big as it did.
Mm.
But that's also what it, caused it to be discredited and attacked.
Well, it's changed a lot even in the last, you know, 10 years. That whole, now, he could build almost a moat around himself. And back then, the web was relatively limited. You know, even though it was exciting that it was new, it wasn't this kind of like free-formed thing where everybody had that piece of the action the way they do now. Twitter would have saved him on some level, perhaps.
Well, it's funny because that's kind of, I was talking to Chris Matthews about this, and Chris was, I think, a little annoyed at me that I put him in used a clip of his and we didn't get permission. But mm-hmm. he, we were talking about the Rashomon aspect or the Cliff Notes, sort of that all the other people had worked off of to discredit him. They didn't mm-hmm. really know the intricacies of it. And when you work like that, it's so easy to attack someone because, are you saying this? No, I didn't say that. So he had spent, and I make a point in the film, going on a little press tour and going, like, having to clarify what he wrote. And mm-hmm. already that doesn't look good. It's like, no, yeah. I didn't say that, you know. I didn't say they intentionally, you know, are doing this, you know. Looking the other way, yeah, I have proof of that.
Right.
You know? Looking the other way, if you're in business with these people and you know they're bad people, it's like, why are you doing it? You know where the drugs could end up. And that's what he wrote. And the journalists, I think his responsibility was to connect those dots, but he needed better editing, and I think he needed to be able to dig further. You can't just print one story like that. You need to, you know,
yeah.
do follow-ups and follow-ups. So.
And as you said, it is current in that regard. I mean, I think corporations have now, the publicity has now figured out how to overwhelm news, and now this, you know, the story gets laid down, whatever story it is. It can be silly or nothing, or it can be very significant, and once the story is laid down, everybody kind of goes from the same hymn book.
Yeah.
It's very hard to break, if you're against the hymn book, somehow you're more questioned than the people who laid down the hymn in the first place.
Yeah, that's interesting, yeah, yeah. Yeah, it's what I was saying. It's like everyone's working off those cliff notes and those
yeah.
sort of the most, if it, you know, if it bleeds, it leads kind of headline. And that there was a lot of nuance and subtlety to this in this particular story. And there was so many characters and it was so hard to get it all in. It's I still do follow-up reading on it. Like, I'm still amazed by the things that I actually discovered after making the film or being in post-production on the film. I mean, you know that we make a point of showing that the guy was partly vindicated.
Yeah. And still not a happy story.
No, it's not, because he lost his career ended. He was, you know, in terms of his death, his actual death, I mean, he was, I think, his death was that, was the discrediting. I mean, everything he held closest to him was sort of taken away.
Well, he was so passionate about it from the very beginning of the movie. You can, the degree of intensity, once you've lost that thing, you know, and he's lost his family to a great extent.
Yeah.
What do you hang on to? You know, it's like if you're that kind of passionate person, to find a new passion in your 40s is...
No, it's hard. That's what did him in, was that. You know, people say, well, would Gary have committed suicide years later, which was 6 years later, if this didn't happen, if it went another way? I mean, that's hard to answer, because he did suffer from depression, and he did have a lot of issues with that, which ultimately led to his death, but... You know, did this sort of push it along or make it happen sooner, or, you know, or something like that? And I believe, yes, because it's exactly what you said, this idea of, you know, when your bliss is sort of plucked out from under you, it's hard. And if you're already a person that doesn't deal with that well, it's not good.
So was the Leota sequence fun?
Ray's sequence was... his character was sort of a blend of a few people that Webb did talk to. As far as, spoiler alert, I guess, as far as him showing up the way he does, that actually didn't happen. But for me, what it was really about was like this sort of wish fulfillment kind of thing, you know, of like what the guy needed was that golden ticket. He needed that ghost to show up and to be the truth teller. I mean, the tragic irony is the guy ends up using him as a priest, you know, and Gary can't use it. And that's actually what happened. He did speak to a DEA agent that connected a lot of the CIA pilots who were on the CIA bankroll, who were flying drugs during the Contra War, and he wanted to use that as a follow-up, and he was not able to. So that the Ray sequence obviously is representative of that last thing that is clearly something. And the guy frigging admitted to it, you know, so he couldn't use it.
So when you get a piece of that, something like that, when you have the writing, you go get Ray, is it just a joy to make that? I mean, because it's such a kind of delicious piece of theater in a movie pretty straightforward and
yeah, the film, it gets a little more, I always thought like the first half of the movie was, if I could use Alan Pakula as an homage or a reference, the first half is all the President's Men, the second half is more like the Parallax View, is more surreal, is more paranoia, is more isolation, and that's what happened to him. He went further and further away from people, his obsession, like that scene with his wife in the hotel room, you know, if she's like, she's kind of lost him at that moment.
Well, that whole relationship is rendered in a way that actually feels real and intimate, which is not...
Well, it's funny you say that, because I remember, you know, getting notes about, you know, like, shouldn't make it clear that they, you know, that they separate or that they get divorced or... Mm. And that's not what it was about. It was about him going further and further out, you know, and by himself. And she starts to... She was with him all the way, but obviously all his, you know, his infidelity and things like that, which is based, in fact, that coming up as a result of him having to be obsessed with this thing is what pushed them further away and pushed him further away from everyone else.
So is this a tough movie to cut? Or are you?
Yes, very hard. It was very hard to edit. It was.
Because?
It was. Because mainly the middle of the movie took me a while because, you know, I wasn't, you know, I brought in a lot of stock photography and the whole series of him writing the story as well as that machine that turned around against him and all those sound bites and stuff. That took a while to get right, to get the rhythm of that right. So it took a while to edit in that way. I mean, you know, movies are different than TV. TV sort of just pieces it together. Movies, like, they take longer.
Is there much improv? Is there much variation?
I would say the scenes that are improvised are more the family stuff is improvised. A lot.
Because you have a lot of fairly like small group kind of intimate scenes, sequences mm-hmm. in the picture mm-hmm. that you would think they could, you know.
I would say the scenes with the family were very improvised. You know, the scenes in the paper, you know, Peter Landesman, who wrote the script, was a journalist, so, you know, he knew the talk, as well as Nick Scow, who wrote Kill the Messenger, mm. the book that it's based on. A lot of those, the dialogue, or at least the set piece, sorry, came from that. You know, as far as, like, them doing follow-up, they sent the guy out to do follow-up and finding out a lot of these people changed their stories, or he found other things that Gary purported that weren't, say, were there were holes in it. That was all in the script. You know, when you play a scene, you get it up on its feed, and maybe you give a line to Oliver Platt, and because you wanted his character to be much more of the boss and clear on who he was. But, you know, that last scene was definitely a Kafka-esque kind of moment where everything is sort of turning on him. So it was important to, to just get the scene up on its feet, change a few lines. I mean, one thing, there was a lot of exposition in some scenes that I cut because it was sort of redundant. So that took a while, because I love the scene so much, but it's just like, just write the story already, you know? So we ran into that. The moment that he basically says, I'm writing the story, and mm-hmm. After he's threatened, or, you know, is that what does that really mean? which actually happened to him. He was called into a DEA meeting, like that, a weird secret meeting, and these guys sort of said some creepy shit about his family, and he was like, fuck you, and he left. So that happened. But I remember we had other scenes in between that and him writing the story of more pitching and more this and more that, and it was like, it's just, you know, dramatically, he didn't need it.
So Oliver Platt, not surprising at all in that role. Mary Elizabeth Winstead, a little surprising. I think of all the casting in this movie.
That's in what way?
Because I guess you think of her as younger, and you think of her as she's usually, you know, playing different kinds of roles. I mean, it works, but it was an interesting choice.
You think of her, it was important for that character to be young, to be wanting the big story like Gary and supporting him, but ultimately, you know, she wants to keep her job. So there was a little naivete to her character that I think that I needed to portray, and she's, you know, she's just a really good actress, and she's very smart. So, it was based on that, you know.
And you certainly did not glam her up, you.
What's that?
You planed her out rather than glammed her up.
Oh yeah. Well, no one's glammed in the movie.
No.
You know, even though I think Rosemary is like lovely in the film. I'm always taking makeup away, and I just want to, you know, need it to be real.
So does this, you're about to go come out in theaters, mm-hmm. is that nerve-wracking for you still, or have you done your work and you're kind of moving on?
I made it. I've been with this film for 2 years now. You just kind of move on to the next thing. I think that, I feel like I've made a film that will stand the test of time and will be archival and will be something referred to in a real important way. As you know, I screened it in DC for the MPAA and Dodd and Chris Matthews. You know, to I've never done that before. I'm so not that kind of guy, and I was quite intimidated by them, but at the same time, they understood the movie emotionally. So I feel I'm proud of its content, and I think it's just a necessary piece.